If you shall chance to visit us this evening, you shall see great difference betwixt Bohemia and Sicilia. These past 9 months, the King of Bohemia has paid Sicilia the visitation which she justly owes him.
Sicilia cannot show himself overkind to Bohemia.
They were trained together in their childhoods,
and there rooted betwixt them then such an affection,
which cannot choose but branch now.
Their mature dignities and royal necessities made separation of their society.
Their encounters, though not personal, have been royally attorneyed with interchange
of gifts,
letters, loving embassies.
They have seemed to be together, though absent.
I think there is neither matter nor malice in the world that can separate them.
Cecilia has also an unspeakable comfort in his young prince, Mamilius.
He is a gentleman of the greatest promise.
He is one that makes old hearts fresh.
They that went on crutches ere he was born desire yet their life to see him again.
If the king had no son, they would desire to live on crutches till he had one.
Nine changes of the watery star have been the shepherd's note since we have left our throne. Time as long again would be fine, my brother, with our thanks. And yet, we should go hence in debt. Therefore, I multiply with one, we thank you, many thousands more that go before it.
Stay your thanks a while and pay them when you part.
Sir, that's tomorrow. I'm questioned by my fears of what may chance or breed upon our absence, that may blow no sneeping winds at home. Besides, I have stayed to tire your royalty.
We are tougher, brother, than you can put us to it.
I must no longer stay.
1 7-night longer.
Very sooth, tomorrow.
We'll part the time betweens then, and in that I'll no gainsaying.
Press me not, beseech you so. There is no tongue that moves, none in the world so soon as yours could win me. Besides, my affairs do even drag me homeward. Farewell, our brother.
Tongue-tied, our queen, speak you.
I had thought, sir, to have held my peace until you had drawn oaths from him to stay. You, sir, charge him too coldly. Tell him you're sure all in Bohemia's well.
Well said, Hermione.
He longs to see his son is strong, yet of your royal presence, I'll adventure the borrow of a week. You'll stay?
No, madam.
Nay, but you will.
I may not, verily.
Verily? You put me off with limber vows, but I should yet say, verily you shall not go. A lady's verily's as potent as a lord's. Force me to keep you as a prisoner, not like a guest. How say you, my prisoner or my guest? By your dread, verily, one of them you shall be.
Your guest then, madam. To be a prisoner should import offending, which is for me less easy to commit than you to punish.
Not your jailer then, but your kind hostess. Come, I'll question you of my lord's tricks and yours when you were boys. You were pretty lordings then.
We were, fair queen. Two lads that thought there was no more behind but such a day tomorrow as today. And to be boy eternal.
Was not my husband the verier wag of the two?
We were as twinned lambs that did frisk in the sun and bleat the one at the other. We knew not the doctrine of ill-doing, nor dreams that any did. Had we pursued that life, we should have answered heaven boldly and not guilty.
By this we gather you have tripped since.
Oh, my most sacred lady, temptations have then since been born to us.
Is he one yet?
He'll stay, my lord.
At my request, he would not. Hermione, my dearest, thou never spokest to better purpose.
Never?
Never, but once.
What? Have I twice said well? When was before? I prithee, tell me. My last good deed was to entreat his stay. What was my first?
Why, that was when 3 crabbed months had soured themselves to death. Ere I could make thee open thy white hand and clap thyself my love, then didst thou utter, I am yours forever.
'Tis grace indeed. Why, look you now, I have spoke to the purpose twice. The one forever earned a royal husband, the other for some while a friend.
Too hot, too hot. To mingle friendship far as mingling bloods. My heart dances, but not for joy, not joy. To be paddling palms and pinching fingers as now they are, and making practiced smiles as in a looking glass, and then to sigh. Oh, that is entertainment my bosom likes not, nor my brows. Mamilius! Art thou my boy?
Hi, my good lord.
What? As much thy nose. They say it is a copy out of mine. Come, captain, we must be neat. Not neat, but cleanly, captain.
They say we are alike as eggs.
Women say so. That will say anything. Yet were it true to say this boy were like me. Come, Sir Page. Look on me with your eye, sweet villain. Most dearest. Can thy mother? May it be? Affection! Thou dost make things possible, not so held. Communicatest with dreams. How can this be?
What means Cecilia?
He something seems unsettled.
What, my lord? How is it with you, best brother?
You look as if you held a brow of much distraction. Are you moved, my lord?
No. In good earnest, looking on the lines of my boy's face, methought it did recoil. 23 years, and saw myself in my green velvet coat, my dagger muzzled, lest it should bite its master, and so prove, as ornaments oft do, too dangerous. How like, methought, I then was to this boy, mine honest friend. Will you let others cheat you?
No, my lord. I'll fight.
You will? Why, happy man. My brother, do you seem to be so fond of your young prince as we do seem to be of ours?
If at home, sir, he's all my exercise, my mirth, my manner. Now my sworn friend and then mine enemy, my parasite, my soldier, my statesman, my all.
So stands this squire with me. We two will walk, my lord, and leave you to your graver steps. Hermione, how thou lovest us, show in our brothers welcome.
If you would seek us, we are yours in the garden.
To your own bents dispose you. You'll be found, be you beneath the sky. I am angling now, though you perceive me not how I give line. Go to. Gone already. Go play, boy, play. My mother plays, and I play too, but so disgraced a part, whose issue will hiss me to my grave. Contempt and clamor will be my knell. Many thousands have the disease, and feel it not. How now, boy?
They say we are alike.
Go play, Mamilius. Thou art an honest man. Camillo! This great sir will yet stay longer.
You had much ado to make his anchor hold.
Didst note it.
He would not stay at your petitions.
Didst perceive it. They're here with me already. Whispering. How came it, Camillo, that he did stay?
At the good queen's entreaty.
At the queen's be it. Good. Was this taken by any understanding, paid but thine?
My lord, I think most know Bohemia stays here longer.
Aye, but why?
To satisfy your highness, and the entreaties of her most gracious mistress.
Satisfy? The entreaties of your mistress? Satisfy? Let that suffice. I have trusted thee, Camillo, with all the nearest things to my heart, as well my chamber councils, wherein priests like thou hast cleansed my bosom. I have departed from thee, thy penitent reformed, but we have been deceived in thy integrity, deceived in that which seems so.
Be it forbid, my lord.
To bite upon it, thou art not honest. Or, if thou inclinest that way, thou art a coward, restraining from course required.
My gracious lord, I may be negligent, foolish, and fearful. In every one of these, no man is free. But in your affairs, my lord, if ever I were willful negligent, it was my folly. If industriously I played the fool, it was my negligence, not weighing well the end. If ever fearful to do a thing, 'twas a fear which oft infects the wisest. These, my lord, are such allowed infirmities that honesty is never free of. But beseech your grace, be plainer with me. Let me know my trespass. If I then deny it, 'tis none of mine.
Have not you seen, Camillo? but that's past doubt. You have or heard. If thou wilt confess to have nor eyes nor ears, then say my wife's a hobby horse. Deserves a name or rank as any flax wench.
I would not be a standerby to hear my sovereign mistress clouded so, without my present vengeance taken. Shrew my heart, you never spoke what did become you less than this.
Is whispering nothing? Is leaning cheek to cheek, meeting noses, skulking in corners, wishing clocks more swift. Hours, minutes, noon, midnight, is this nothing? Why, then the world and all that's in it is nothing. The covering sky is nothing. Bohemia is nothing, nor my wife is nothing, nor nothing. Have these nothings, if this be nothing.
Good, my lord, be cured of this diseased opinion, for 'tis most dangerous.
See it be, 'tis true!
No, no, my lord.
It is, you lie, I see thou liest, Camillo, and I hate thee, a mindless slave!
Who does infect her?
Why, he that wears her like a medal, hanging about his neck. Bohemia. Who, if I had servants true about me, would do that which should undo more doing. I, and his cupbearer, might spice a cup to give mine enemy a lasting wink.
Sir, I could do that with a lingering dram that should not work maliciously like poison. But I cannot believe this crack to be in my dread mistress. So sovereignly being honorable, I have loved thee.
Go rot! Dost thou think I am so muddy, so unsettled in my own vexation, that I would bring scandal to the blood of the prince, my son, who I love as mine and do think is mine? Would I do this?
I must believe you, sir. I do, and will fetch Bohemia off for it. Provided that, when he's removed, you'll take your queen as yours at first, even for your son's sake. And thereby sealing the injury of tongues in courts and kingdoms known and allied to yours.
Thou dost advise me, even so as mine own course have set down. I'll give no blemish to her honor, none.
My lord, go then, and with countenance as clear as friendship wears at feasts, keep with Bohemia. And with your queen. I am his cupbearer. If from me he have wholesome beverage, account me not your servant.
This is all. Do it, and thou hast the one half of my heart. Do it not, and thou splits thine own.
I'll do it, my lord.
I will seem friendly, as thou hast advised me.
Oh, miserable lady, I am to be the poisoner of good Polixenes. And my ground to do it is the obedience to a master, one who in rebellion with himself would have all that are his to do so. To do this deed, promotion follows. If I could find example of thousands that had struck anointed kings and flourished after, I'd not do it. I must forsake the court. To do it or no is certain to me a breakneck.
This is strange. Methinks my favor here begins to warp. Good day, Camillo.
Hail, most royal sir.
What is the news in the court?
None rare, my lord.
The king hath on him such a countenance as he had lost some province in a region, loved he as he loves himself. Even now I met him with customary compliment when he speeds from me and so leads me to consider what is breeding that changes thus his manners.
I dare not know, my lord.
Dare not? Do you know and dare not? Be intelligent to me. What you do know you must, and cannot say you dare not.
There is a sickness which puts some of us in distemper. But I cannot name the disease, and it is caught of you that yet are well.
How? Caught of me? Camillo, as you are certainly a gentleman, I beseech you, if you know aught which does behove my knowledge thereof to be informed, imprison it not in ignorant concealment.
I may not answer.
A sickness caught of me, and yet I will. I must be answered. Dost thou hear, Camillo? I conjure thee, by all the parts of man which honor does acknowledge, that thou declare what incidency thou dost guess if harm is creeping towards me. How far off? How near? How best to be prevented, if to be? If not, how best to bear it?
Sir, I will tell you. Since I am charged in honor, and by him that I think honorable, therefore mark my counsel, which is to be as swiftly followed as I mean to utter it, or both yourself and me cry lost, and so good night.
On, good Camillo.
I am appointed to murder you.
By whom?
By the king.
For what?
He thinks, nay, with all confidence, he swears, that you'd have touched his queen forbiddenly.
Turn then my freshest reputation to a savor that may strike the duelist's nostril. Where I arrive, and my approach be shunned, nay, hated too, worse than the greatest infection that was ever heard or read. How should this grow?
I know not, but I am sure 'tis safer to avoid what's grown than to question how 'tis born. If you therefore dare trust my honesty, away tonight. For myself, I'll put my fortunes to your service, which are here by this discovery lost. Be not uncertain, for by the honor of my parents, I've uttered truth.
I do believe thee. I saw his heart in his face. Give me thy hand. Be pilots to me, and thy places shall still neighbor mine. My ships are ready, and my people did expect my hence departure 2 days ago. This jealousy is for a precious creature. As she's rare, must it be great. And as his person's mighty, must it be violent. And as he does conceive, he is dishonored by a man which ever professed to him. Why, his revenge is in that must be made more bitter. Fear overshades me. Good expedition be my friend. And comfort the gracious queen, part of his theme, but nothing of his ill-taken suspicion. Come, Camillo, I will respect thee as a father if thou bearest my life off hence. Let us avoid.
It is in mine authority to command the keys of all the posterns, to take the urgent hour. Come, sir, away.
Take the boy to you. He so troubles me. 'Tis past enduring.
Come, my gracious lord. Shall I be your playfellow?
No. Hold none of you.
Why, my sweet lord?
You kiss me hard and speak to me if I were a baby still. I love you better.
And why so, my lord?
Your brows are blacker.
Who taught you this?
I learned to our own faces. Pray now, what color are your eyebrows?
Blue, my lord.
Nay, that's a mock. I've seen a lady's nose blue, but not her eyebrows.
Hark ye, the queen your mother rounds apace. We shall present our services to a fine new prince one day, and then you'd want us if we would have you.
Come, sir, now I am for you again. I pray you, sit by us and tell us a tale.
Merry as that shall it be.
As merry as you will.
A sad tale is best for winter. I have one of sprites and goblins.
Let's have that, good sir. Come on, sit down. Come on and do your best to fright me with your sprites. You're powerful at it.
There wasn't...
Nay, come, sit down, then on.
Who drove a man who drove by a churchyard? I will tell us all if your kids should not hear it.
Come on, then.
Was he met there, his train? Camilla with him?
Beyond the tuft of pines, I met them. I eyed them, even to their ships.
How blessed am I in my true opinion? How accursed in being so blessed? There may be in the cup a spider steeped, and one may drink, depart, and partake no venom, for his knowledge has not been infected. But if one present the abhorred ingredient to his eye, make known how he hath drunk, he cracks his sides with violent hefts. I have drunk and seen the smiter. Camilla was his help in this. There's a plot against my life, my crown. All's true that is mistrusted. That false villain whom I employed was pre-employed by him. He has discovered my design, and I remain a very trick for them to play at will. How came it the postern so easily open?
By Camilla's great authority.
I know it too well. Give me the boy! Though he does bear some signs of me, yet you have too much blood in him.
What is this, sport?
Bear the boy hence, he shall not come about her. Away with him! And let her sport herself with that she's big with. For 'tis Polixenes has made thee swell thus.
But I'll say he had not, and I'll be sworn you would believe my saying.
You, my lords, look on her. Mark her well, for 'tis pity she's not honest, honorable. She's an adulteress.
Should a villain say so? You, my lord, do but mistake.
You have mistook, my lady. Polixenes for Leontes, oh, thou thing! She's an adulteress, I have said with whom, and more, she's a traitor, and Camilla's a federary with her, and she's privy to this, their late escape.
No, by my life, privy to none of this, you did mistake.
No, away with her, to prison. He who shall speak for her is guilty.
My good lords, I am not prone to weeping, as our sex commonly are. The want of which vain dew perchance shall dry your pities. But I have that honorable grief here, which burns worse than tears drown. Beseech you all, my lords, measure me, and so the king's will be performed. Who is that goes with me? Beseech your highness, for my women may be with me, for you see my plight requires it. Adieu, my lord. I never wished to see you sorry. Now I trust I shall. Come, my lady, you have leave.
Go! Do our bidding hence.
Beseech your highness, call the queen again.
Be certain what you do, sir, lest your justice prove violence, in the which three great ones suffer, yourself, your queen, your son.
For her, my lord, I dare my life lay down and would do it. Please, you too accept it, that the queen is spotless, and is of heaven and to you.
Aye. Every woman is false, if she be.
Hold your pieces.
Good, my lord.
It is for you we speak, not for ourselves. You are abused, and by some trickster, would I knew the villain.
Cease! No more! You smell this business with a sense as cold as a dead man's nose, but I do see it and feel it.
If it be so, we need no grave to bury honesty. There's not a grain of it to sweeten the whole dungy earth.
What? Like I credit?
I had rather you did lack than I, my lord. Upon this ground and more, it would content me to have her honor true than your suspicion.
Our prerogative calls not your counsels, but our natural goodness imparts this. If thou cannot or will not relish a truth like us, inform yourselves. We need no more of your advice.
I wish, my liege, you had only in your silent judgment tried the matter without more overture.
How could that be? Either thou art most ignorant by age or thou wert born a fool. Camilla's flight added to their familiarity. Yet, for a greater confirmation, I have dispatched in post to Apollo's temple Cleomenes and Dion. Now, from the oracle, they will bring all whose spiritual counsel shall stop or spur me. Have I done well?
Well done, my lord.
Though I am satisfied and need no more than what I know, yet shall the oracle bring rest to the minds of others. Come, follow us. We are to speak in public, for this business will raise us all
to laughter, if the good truth were known.
Now, good sir, you know me, do you not?
For a worthy lady, and one whom much I honor.
Pray you then, conduct me to the queen.
I mean not, madam, to the contrary, I have express commandments.
Here's ado, to lock up honesty and honor from the access of gentle visitors. Is it lawful, pray you, to see her woman, any of them, Amelia?
So please you, madam, I shall bring Amelia for her. And madam, I must be present at your conference.
Well, be it so, prithee. Dearest gentlewoman, how fares our gracious lady?
As well as one so great and forlorn may hold together, she's something before her time delivered.
A boy.
A daughter, and a goodly babe, lustly and likely to live. The queen receives much comfort, and it says, my poor prisoner, I am as innocent as you.
The king must be told of it, and he shall. The office becomes a woman best. I'll take it upon me. Pray you, Amelia, if the queen dares trust me with her little babe, I'll show it the king and undertake to be her advocate to the loudest. We do not know how he may soften at the sight of the child. The silence, often of pure innocence, persuades when speaking fails.
Most worthy madam, your honor and your goodness is evident. There's no lady living so proper for his great end. I'll presently acquaint the queen with the most noble offer.
Tell her, Amelia, I'll use that tongue I have, if wit flow from it as boldness from my bosom. Let it not be doubted, I shall do good.
Now be you blessed for it, all to the queen.
Madam, if so please the queen to send the babe, I know not what shall incur to pass it. Have no warrant.
You need not fear it, sir. The child is a prisoner to the womb, and is by law and process of great nature thence freed, not guilty, if any be, of the queen's trespasses.
I do believe it.
Do not you fear. Upon mine honor, I will stand betwixt you and danger.
Nor night, nor day, nor rest. It is but weakness to hear the matter thus. Mere weakness. Who's there?
My lord.
How does the boy?
He took good rest tonight. 'Tis hoped his sickness is discharged.
To see his nobleness, conceiving the dishonor of his mother, he straight declined and downright languished. Go, leave me solely. See how the boy fares. Fie, no thought of him. Camillo and Polixenes, they laugh at me, make their pastime at my sorrow. They should not laugh if I could reach them, nor shall she within my power.
You must not enter.
Nay, rather, good, my lords, be second to me. fear you, his tyrannous passion, more, alas, than the queen's life? A gracious, innocent soul, more free than he is jealous.
That's enough.
Madam, he hath not slept last night. Command none come at him.
Not so hot, good sir. I come to bring him sleep. To such as you, that creep like shadows by him, nourish the cause of his awaking. I do come with words as medicinal as true, honest as either, to purge him of that humor which presses him from sleep.
What noise there?
No noise, my lord, but needful conference about some gossips for your highness.
Thou, away with that audacious lady! Antigonus, I charge thee that she should not come about me. I knew she would.
I told her so, my lord, that on your displeasure's peril, and on mine, she should not visit you.
What? Canst not rule her?
From all dishonesty, he can. In this, unless he take the course which you have done, commit me for committing honor, trust it, he shall not rule me.
When she will take the rein, I let her run, but she'll not stumble.
Good, my liege. I come, and I beseech you, hear me who profess myself your loyal servant. I come from your good queen.
Good queen!
Good queen! Good queen! I say good queen, and would by combat make her good.
Forth her hence!
Let him that makes but trifles of his eyes first hand me. On mine own accord, I'll leave. But first, I'll do my errand. The good queen, for she is good, hath brought you forth a daughter. Here 'tis, commends it to your blessing.
Out! Hence with her! Out the door!
Not so! I am no less honest than you are mad!
Traitors! Will you not push her out? Give her the breath!
Forever unvenerable be thy hands if thou takest up the princess!
He dreads his wife!
So I would you did! Then twere past all doubt you'd call your children yours!
A nest of traitors!
I am none by this good light.
Nor I. Nor any but one that's here. And that's himself. For he will not once remove the root of his opinion, which is as rotten as ever oak or stone was sound.
This brat is none of mine. It is but the issue of Polixenes. Hence with it, together with the mother, cast them to the fire.
It is yours! And might we lay the old proverb to your charge? So like you, 'tis the worse. Behold, my lords, although the print be little, the whole matter and copy of the father. Eye, nose, lip, the trick of his frown, his forehead, nay, the valley, the pretty dimples of his chin and cheek, his smiles, the very mold and frame of hand, nail, finger.
A gross hag, and thou art worthy to be hanged. I will not stay her tongue.
Hang all the husbands that cannot do that feat. You leave yourself hardly one subject.
Once more, take her hence.
A most unworthy and unnatural lord can do no more.
I'll have thee burned.
I care not. It is a heretic that makes the fire, not she which burns in it. I'll not call you tyrant, but this most cruel usage of your queen, unable to produce more accusation than your own weak, hinged fancy. Something savors of tyranny and will ignoble make you, yea, scandalous to the world.
On your allegiance, out of the chamber with her!
I pray you, do not push me. I'll be gone. Look to your babe, my lord. 'Tis yours.
Thou, traitor, hast set thy wife to this, my child? Away with it, even thou that has a heart so tender over it. Take it and see it instantly consumed with fire, even thou and none but thou. Look at me! Take it to the fire, and within this hour bring me word to son and my good testimony, or I'll seize thy life! Go, take it to the fire, for thou sets it on thy wife!
I did not, sir. This lord, my noble fellow, if he pleases, can clear me in it.
I can, my royal liege. He is not guilty of her coming hither.
You're liars! Oh!
Beseech your highness, give us better credit, for we have always truly served you. And on our knees we beg that you do change his purpose, which being so horrible, so bloody, must lead on to some foul issue. We all kneel.
Shall I live on to see this creature kneel and call me father? Better burn it now than curse it then. But be it, let it live. You, sir, come you hither. What will you adventure to save this brat's life?
Anything, my lord. I'll pawn the little blood which I have left to save the innocent. Anything possible.
It shall be possible. Swear by this sword thou wilt perform our bidding.
I will.
Mark and perform it. Seest thou, for the fail of any point shall not only be death to thyself, but to thy wife, whom for this time we pardon. We enjoin thee, as thou art liegeman to us, that thou carry this female creature hence, and that thou bear it to some remote and desert place, quite out of our dominions, and that there thou leave it without more mercy to its own protection in my favor of the climate. As by strange fortune it came to us, I do in justice charge thee. On thy soul's peril and on thy body's torture, that thou strangely commend it to some place where chance may nurse or end it. Take it up.
I swear to do this, though a present death would have been more merciful.
Come, poor babe. Wolves and bears, they say, casting aside their savageness, have done offices of pity. Poor thing, condemned to loss.
Please, your highness, post. Cleomenes and Dion, being well arrived from Delphos, are both landed, hasting to the court.
Ah, 23 days they have been absent. 'Tis good speed. Foretells the great Apollo will suddenly have the truth. Prepare you, lords, summon a session that we may arraign our most disloyal lady. For, as she hath been publicly accused, so shall she have a just and open trial. Leave me. This session, to our great grief we pronounce, let us be cleared of being tyrannous, since we so openly proceed in justice, even to the guilt or the purgation. Produce the prisoner.
It is His Highness's pleasure that the Queen appear in person here in court. Silence.
Read the indictment.
Hermione, queen to the worthy Leontes, king of Sicilia. Thou art here accused and arraigned of high treason in committing adultery with Polixenes, king of Bohemia, and conspiring with Camillo to take away the life of our sovereign lord, the king, thy royal husband.
Since what I am to say must be but that which contradicts my accusation, it shall scarce help me to say not guilty. But thus, if powers divine behold our human actions as they do, I doubt not then but innocence shall make false accusation blush and tyranny tremble at patience. You, my lord, best know my past life hath been as chaste, as true, as I am now unhappy. For behold, me, a fellow to the royal king, the mother to a hopeful prince, here standing I appeal to your own conscience, sir.
You will not own it.
For Polixenes, with whom I am accused, I do confess I loved him, as in honor he required it, with such a kind of love as might become a lady like me, with a love even such, so and no other, as yourself commanded. Now, for conspiracy, I know not how it tastes. All I know of it is that Camillo was an honest man, and why he left your court, the gods themselves, knowing no more than I, are ignorant.
You knew of his departure, as you know what you have undertaken to do in his absence.
Sir, you speak a language I understand not.
Your actions are my dreams. As thy brat hath been cast out, no father owning it, so shalt thou feel our justice, and whose easiest passage look for no less than death.
Sir, spare your threats. The bug which you would fright me with, I seek. To me can life be no commodity. The crown and comfort of my life, your favor, I do give lost, for I do feel it gone. But know not how it went. My second joy and first fruits of my body, from his presence I am barred, like one infectious. My third comfort, starred most unluckily, is from my breast the innocent milk in its most innocent mouth, haled out to murder. Now, my liege, tell me what blessings I have here alive, that I should fear to die? Therefore, proceed. I do refer me to the oracle. Apollo be my judge.
Your request is altogether just. Therefore, and in Apollo's name, his oracle.
You here shall swear upon this sword of justice, that you, Cleomenes and Dion, have been both at Delphos, and from thence have brought the sealed up oracle by the hand delivered of great Apollo's priest, and that since then you have not dared to break the holy seal nor read the secrets in it.
All this we swear.
Break up the seals and read.
Hermione is chaste. Polixenes, blameless. Camillo, a true subject. Leontes, a jealous tyrant. His innocent babe truly begotten, and the king shall live without an heir, if that which is lost be not found.
Hast thou read truth?
Aye, my lord, even so as it is here set down.
There's no truth at all in the oracle. The session shall proceed. This is mere falsehood.
Oh, my lord, the king.
What is the business?
Oh, sir, I shall be handed to report it. The prince, son, is gone.
Gone?
He's dead.
Apollo's angry. And the heavens do strike in my injustice.
The news is mortal to the queen. Look down and see what death is doing.
Take her hands. Her heart is but overcharged. She will recover. I believe too much in mine own suspicion. I beseech you tenderly apply to her some remedies for life. I'll reconcile me to Polixenes. New woo, my queen. Recall the good Camillo, whom I proclaim a man of truth, of mercy. How he glisters through my rust, and how his pity my deeds make the blacker.
Woe the while. Oh, cut my lace, lest my heart cracking it break too.
What fit is this, good lady?
What studied torments, tyrant, hast for me? What wheels, racks, fires, what flaying, boiling! Oh, think what they have done, and gone mad indeed, stark mad! That thou betrayest Polixenes, 'twas nothing. Nor was it much thou wouldst have poisoned good Camillo's honor. I reckon the casting forth to cross thy baby daughter to be of none or little account. Nor is it directly laid to thee the death of the young prince. This is not, no, laid to thy answer, but the last. O lords, the queen, the queen, the sweetest, dearest creature. Is dead! And vengeance for it not dropped down yet. I'll say she's dead! I'll swear it! If word or oath prevail not, go and see! But oh, thou tyrant, do not repent of these things. For they are heavier than all thy woes can stir. Therefore, betake thee to nothing but despair.
Go on. Go on. Thou canst speak too much but the truth. I have deserved all tongues to talk their bitterest.
Please, say no more.
Alas, I have showed too much the rashness of a woman. Sir, royal sir, forgive a foolish woman. The love I bore your queen. Lo, fool again. I'll speak of her no more, nor of your children. I'll not remind you of mine own lord, who is lost to. I'll say nothing.
Thou didst speak well, but the truth. Come, prithee. Bring me to the dead bodies of my queen and son. One grave shall be for both. Once a day, I'll visit the chapel where they lie, and tears shed there shall be my recreation. So long as nature bears up with this exercise, so long I daily vow to use it. Come and lead me unto these sorrows.
Our ship hath touched upon the desert of Bohemia.
I'm alone, in fear and land in ill times. The sky looks grimly and threatened presence bluster.
Go, get aboard. Look to thy bark. I'll not be long before I call upon thee.
Make your best haste and don't go far too in the land. It's like to be loud weather. Besides, this place is famous for creatures of prey that kept the pond.
Go thou away. I'll follow instantly. Come, poor babe. I have heard, but not believed. The spirits of the dead may walk again. If such thing be, thy mother appeared to me last night. For never was a dream so like a waking. To me comes a creature. A nun did this break from her.
Good Antigonus. Since fate hath made thy person for the thrower out of my poor babe, places remote enough are in Bohemia. There weep and leave it crying. And for the babe is counted lost forever. Perdita, I prithee, call it. For this ungentle business put on thee by my lord,
thou never shalt see thy wife Paulina more. And so, with shrieks, she melted into air. Dreams are toys. Yet for this once, yea, superstitiously, I do believe Hermione hath suffered death. And that Apollo, would it should here be laid, either for life or death. Blossom, speed thee well. There lie. The storm begins. Poor wretch, that for thy mother's fault are thus exposed to loss. And what may follow? Weep I cannot, but my heart bleeds, and most accursed am I to be by oath enjoined to this. Farewell. A savage clamor! This is the chase! I am gone forever!
I would there no wage! Between 16 and 22,
or that youth would sleep out the rest. For there is nothing in between but wronging the ancient tree, stealing, fighting. Hark you now! Would any but these boiled brains of 22 hunt this weather? They have scared away 2 of my best sheep. Mercy's on us. A bairn, a very pretty bairn, be it a boy or a maid, I wonder. A pretty one, a very pretty one. I'll take it to pity, yet I'll tarry till my son comes home. Whoa, whoa!
Hello, aloha!
Art thou so near? What ailest thou, man?
I've seen 2 such sights, by sea and by land.
My boy, how is it?
I would you did but see how it chafes, how it rages, how it takes up the shore. But that's not the point. Oh, the most piteous cry of the poor souls, sometimes to see him, and not to see him. Now the ship boring the moon with her main mast, and anon swallowed with yeast and froth. Now the land service, to see how the bear tore out his shoulder bone. She him cried to me for help, saying his name was Antigonus, a nobleman. Now to make an end of the ship, to see how the sea flat dragoned it. But first, how the poor souls roared, and the sea mocked them. And the poor gentleman roared, and the bear mocked him, both roaring louder than the sea or weather.
Name of mercy, when was this?
Now, I have not winked once since I saw these sights. The men are not yet cold under water, nor the bear half done on the gentleman. He's at it now.
If only I had been by to have helped the old man.
I would you had been by the ship's side to have helped her.
Heavy matters, heavy matters. Thou meddest with things dying, yet I with things newborn. Take up. It was told me I were to be rich by the fairies. This is some changeling. Open it. What's within?
You're a maid, old man. The sins of your youth have forgiven you. You're well to live. Gold. All gold.
This is fairy gold, boy. And 'twill prove so. Come, take up. Keep it close. Home, home the next way. Let my sheep go. Come, good boy. The next way home.
You go the next way with your findings. I'll go see if the bear be gone from the gentleman, and how much he hath eaten. They are never cursed but when they are hungry. If there be anything left of him, I'll bury it.
If thou mayest discern that which is left of him, that he is. Fetch to me the sight of him.
Marry will I, and you shall help me put him in the ground.
'Tis a lucky day, boy, and we shall do good things on it.
I that please some, try all both joy and terror, of good and bad, that makes and unfolds air. Now take upon me, in the name of time, to use my wings. Impute it not a crime to me or my swift passage that I slide over 16 years. Your patience this allowing, I turn my glass and give my scene such growing as you had slept between. Leontes leaving, the effects of his fond jealousy so grieving that he shuts up himself. Imagine me, gentle spectators, that I now may be in fair Bohemia. And remember well, I mentioned a son of the king's, which Florizel I now name to you. And with speed so paced to speak of Perdita, now grown in grace, equal with wondering. What of her ensues, I list not prophecy, but let time's news be known when 'tis brought forth. A shepherd's daughter, and what to her adheres, which follows after, is the argument of time.
I pray thee, good Camillo, be no more importunate. 'Tis a sickness denying thee anything, a death to grant this.
It has been 15 years since I saw my country. Though I have, for the most part, been aired abroad, I desire to lay my bones there. Besides, the penitent king, my master, hath sent for me, which is another spur to my departure.
As thou lovest me, Camillo, wipe not out the rest of thy services by leaving me now. Thou, having made me businesses which none without thee can sufficiently manage, must either stay to execute them thyself, or take away with thee the very services thou hast done. Of that fatal country, Sicilia, prithee speak no more, whose name punishes me with the remembrance of that penitent, as thou callest him, and reconciled king, my brother, whose loss of his most precious queen and children are even now to be afresh lamented. Say to me, when sawest thou the Prince Florizel, my son?
Sir, it has been 3 days since I last saw the prince. What his happier affairs may be are to me unknown, but I have missingly noted he is of late much retired from court, and is less frequent to his princely exercises than he formerly hath been.
I have considered so much, Camillo, and with some care, so far that I have eyes under my service which look upon his removedness, from whom I have this intelligence, that he is seldom from the home of a most homely shepherd, a man, they say, that from very nothing and beyond the imagination of his neighbors is grown into an unspeakable estate.
I have heard, sir, of such a man, who hath a daughter of most rare note.
That is, likewise, part of my intelligence. But I fear the angle that plucks our son thither. Thou shalt accompany us to the place where we will, not appearing what we are, have some question with the shepherd, from whose simplicity I think it not uneasy to get the cause of my son's resort thither. Prithee, be my present partner in this business, and lay aside the thoughts of Sicilia.
I willingly obey your command.
My best Camillo, we must disguise ourselves.
When daffodils begin to peer with high, the doxy o'er the dale, why then comes in the sweet o' the year. I have served Prince Florizel, but now I am out of service. But shall I go mourn for that, my dear? The pale moon shines by night, and when I go here and there, I then most do go right. My father named me Autolycus, who was a snapper up of unconsidered trifles, and my revenue is this silly cheat.
Let me see. What am I to buy for our sheep shearing? 3 pounds of sugar, 5 pounds of currants, rice. Rice? What will this sister of mine do with rice? But my father hath made a mistress of the feast, and she lays it on. Must have saffron to color the warden pies, mace, dates. No, that's out of my note. Nutmegs, 7, a rice or 2 of ginger, but that I may beg. 4 pounds of prunes, and as many raisins o' the sun.
Oh, that I was born!
In the name of me!
Oh, sir, help me! Help me pluck off with these rags, and then death! Death!
Alack, poor soul, thou hast needest of more rags to put on thee rather than have these off.
Oh, sir, I am robbed and beaten, my money and apparel taken of me, and these detestable things put upon me.
What, by footman or horseman?
A footman, dear sir. A footman.
Indeed, a footman by the garments he has left with thee. Come, lend me thy hand. I'll help thee. Come.
Oh, sir, tenderly. Oh.
Poor soul.
I fear, sir, my shoulder blade is out.
How now? Can't stand?
Oh, sir. You have done me a charitable office. Thank you.
Dost lack any money? I have little money for thee.
No, I pray you, sir. I have a kinsman not past a quarter of a mile hence into tomb which I was going. There I will have money or anything I please. I pray you, sir, that kills my heart.
What manner of fellow is he that robbed you?
A fellow, sir. I knew him once. His virtues I cannot say, but he was certainly whipped out of the court.
His vices, you would say. There is no virtue whipped out of the court.
Vices, I would say. Having flown over many knavish professions, he settled on rogue. Some call him Autolycus.
Out upon him. Prig, for my life, prig, for he haunts wakes, fairs, and bear baitings.
Sir, that's the rogue that put me in this apparel.
Sir, not a rogue in all of Bohemia. If you but stood tall and run, if you stood tall and spit, he'd have run.
I must confess to you, sir, I am no fighter. I am false of heart in that way. And that he knew.
Well, how do you now?
Well, sir, I can walk and pace, and I will even take my leave of you and go towards my kinsmen.
Shall I bring thee on the way?
No, good face, sir, no.
Then fare thee well. I must go buy spices for our sheep shearing.
Prosper you, sweet sir. Your purse is not hot enough. I'll be with you at your sheep shearing, too. And if this cost does not bring out another, then the shears prove sheep. Jog on, the merry way, and merrily hent the silent day. A merry heart goes all the day, and merrily hent the silent A.
These your unusual weeds to each part of you do give a life. This your sheep shearing is as a meeting of the petty gods, and you, the queen on it.
Sir, my gracious lord, your high self, the gracious mark of the land. You have obscured the swain's wearing, and me, poor lowly maid, most goddess-like pranked up. But that our feasts in every mess have folly, I should blush to see you so attired.
I bless the time when my good falcon made her flight across thy father's ground.
Even now I tremble to think your father, by some accident, should pass this way as you did. How would he look to see his work so noble vilely bound up? What would he say? Or how should I, in these my borrowed flaunts, behold the sternness of his presence?
Apprehend nothing but jollity. The gods themselves, humbling their deities to love, have taken the shapes of beasts upon them. Their transformations were never for a piece of beauty rarer.
Oh, but, sir, your resolution cannot hold when 'tis opposed, as it must be, by the power of the king. One of these two must be necessities, which then will speak, that you must change this purpose, or I my life.
Thou dearest Perdita, with these forced thoughts, I prithee, darken not the mirth of the feast. I'll be thine, my fair, not my father's, for I cannot be mine own, nor anything to any, if I be not thine. To this I am most constant, though destiny say no. Be merry, gentle, lift up your countenance, as it were the day of celebration of that nuptial, which we two have sworn shall come. See, your guests approach. Address yourself to entertain them sprightly, and let's be red with mirth.
Fie, daughter! When my old wife lived, she welcomed all, served all. You are but retired, as if you were a feasted one, and not hostess of the meeting. Come, bid our unknown friends welcome, and quench your blushes. Present yourself that as which you are, mistress of the feast. Come you, and bid us welcome to your sheep shearing.
Sir, welcome. It is my father's will I should take on me the hostesship of the day. You're welcome, sir. Reverend sirs, for you, there's rosemary and rue. These keep seeming in savor all the winter long. Grace and remembrance be to you both, and welcome to our shearing.
Shepherdess, a fair one are you. Well, you fit our ages with flowers of winter.
Here's flowers for you. Hot lavender, mint, savory marjoram. These are flowers of middle summer, and I think they are given to men of middle age. You're very welcome.
I should leave grazing were I of your flock, and live only by gazing.
Out alas! You'd be so lean that blasts of January would blow you through and through. Now, my fairest friend, I would I had some flowers of the spring that might become your time of day. All of these I lack to make you garlands of.
What you do still betters what is done. When you speak, sweet, I'll have you do it ever. When you sing, give alms, pray, when you do dance. I wish you a wave of the sea, that you might do nothing but that, that all your acts are queens.
Oh, Doricles, your praises are too large.
Come, our dance, I pray. Your hand, my Perdita, so turtles pair that never mean to part.
This is the prettiest low-born lass that ever ran on the green sword. Nothing she does or seems but smacks of something greater than herself. Too noble for this place.
He tells her something that makes her blood look out. Good sooth. She is the queen of curds and cream.
Come on, strike up!
Thank you.
good shepherd. What fair swain is this which dances with your daughter?
They call him Doricles. He boasts himself a worthy following, and I believe him. He says he loves my daughter, and I think so too. For never the moon gazed upon the water as he'll stand and read, as 'twere my daughter's eyes. And, to be plain, there's not half a kiss to choose who loves another best.
She dances featly.
As she does everything. If young Doricles do light upon her, she shall bring to him that which he does not dream of.
Oh, master, but for you to hail the peddler at the door, you never dance after a tabor and a pipe. He sings several tunes faster than you'll tell money.
He could not have come better. He shall come in. I love a ballad, but even too well. If be doleful, madam merrily sit down. A very pleasant thing indeed, and sung lamentably.
He has songs for men and women of all sizes.
Believe me, you speak of a conceited admiral fellow. Has he any unbraided wares?
He hath ribbons of all the colors in the
rainbow. Prithee, bring him in, and let him approach singing.
Forewarn him that he use no scurrilous words in its tunes.
You have of these peddlers that have more in them than you'd think, sister.
Aye, good brother, or go about to think.
Lawn as white as driven snow, cypress black as Erebus clow, gloves as sweet as damask roses, masks for faces and for noses. Come buy of me, come buy. Come buy, lads, or else your lasses cry. Come buy.
If I were not in love with Mopsa, thou shouldest take no money of me. But being enthralled as I am, it'll be a certain bondage of ribbons and gloves.
I was promised them against the feast, but they come not too late now.
He hath promised you more than that, or there be liars.
He hath paid you all he promised you.
Is there no manners left among maids? Clamor your tongues, and not a word more.
I have done. Come now, you promised me a tawdry lace and a pair of sweet gloves.
And I tell thee, I was deceived along the way and lost all my money.
And behold, sir, there are deceivers abroad. It behoves men to be wary.
Fear not, thou man. You shall lose nothing here.
I hope so, sir.
What hast here? Ballads?
Pray you now, buy some. I love a ballad.
This is a ballad of... this is a very doleful ballad of... A user's wife who longed to eat adders, heads, and toads.
Is it true, think you?
Very true, and but a month old.
Pray you buy it.
Lay it by. Let's first see more ballads. We'll buy the other things anon.
Here is a ballad of a fish that washed up on the coast on Wednesday on the fourscore of April. Yes, on the fourscore of April.
Is it true too, think you?
Very true, and also but a month old.
Lay it by two. Another.
Here is a very merry ballad.
Let's have some merry ones.
This merry ballad goes to the tune of two maids wooing a man.
We can both sing it.
We'll have it sung out and on by ourselves. My father and the gentlemen are in sad talk, and we shall not bother them. Come, bring thy packs after me. Ladies, I'll buy for you both. Peddler, let's have the first choice. Follow me, girls.
And you shall pay well for them. Will you buy any tape or lace for your cape, my dainty duck, my deera? A merry heart goes all the day, and merrily hent the silent day.
Is it not too far gone? 'Tis time to part them. How now, fair shepherd? Your mind is full of something that does take your heart from feasting. Sooth, when I was young and handled love as you do, I would have ransacked the peddler's silken treasury and poured it to her acceptance. You have let him go. Your lass should call this your lack of love.
Old sir, I know she prizes not such trifles as these are. The gifts she looks from me are packed and locked up in my heart, which I have given already, but not yet delivered. Oh, hear me breathe my life before this ancient sir, who, it should seem, hath sometime loved.
But to your protestation, let me hear what you profess.
Do, and be witness to it.
And this my neighbor too.
And he, and more than he, and men, the earth, the heavens, and all, that were I crowned the most imperial monarch, thereof most worthy, were I, the fairest youth that ever made eye swerve, had force and knowledge more than ever was man's. I would not prize them without her love. For her, employ them all.
Fairly offered.
This shows a sound affection.
But my daughter, say you the like to him?
I cannot speak so well. Nothing so well. No, nor mean better.
Take hands, a bargain, and unknown friends, bear witness to it. I shall give my daughter to you, and make her portion equal yours.
Oh, this must be, if the virtue of your daughter, one being dead, I shall have more than you can dream of yet. But enough then for your wonder. But come on, contract us before these witnesses.
Come, your hand, and daughter, yours.
Soft, Swain, a while, beseech you. Have you a father?
I have, but what of him?
Knows he of this?
He neither does, nor shall.
Methinks a father is at the nuptial of his son that best becomes the table. Pray you once more, is not your father grown incapable of reasonable affairs? Is he stupid with age? Can he speak? Hear? No man from man? Dispute his own estate? Lies he not bedrid?
No, good sir. He has his health and ampler strength indeed than most have of his age.
By my white beard, you offer him, if this be so, a wrong, something unfilial. Reason my son should choose himself a wife, but as good reason the father, all whose joy is nothing else but fair posterity, should hold some counsel in such a business.
I yield all this, but for some other reasons, my grave sir, which 'tis not fit you know. I not acquaint my father of this business.
Let him know it.
He shall not.
Prithee, let him.
No! He must not.
Let him know, so that he may not need to grieve at knowing of thy choice.
Come, come. He must not. Mark our contract.
Mark your divorce, young sir. Whom son I dare not call. Thou art too base to be acknowledged. Thou old traitor! I am sorry that by hanging thee, I can shorten thy life but 1 week. And thou, fresh piece of excellent witchcraft.
Oh, my heart.
I will have thy beauty scratched with briars and made more homely than thy state. For thee, fond boy, no more shalt thou see this girl. As never I meant thou shalt. Will bar thee from succession. Not hold thee of our blood. No, not our kin. Mark thou my words. Follow us to the court, thou churl. For this time, through full of our displeasure, yet we free thee from the dead blow of it. And thou, enchantment, if ever, henceforth, these rural latches to his entrance open, or hoop his body more with thy embraces, I will devise a death as cruel for thee as thou art tender to it.
Even here undone, will it please you, sir, be gone. I told you what would come of this. Beseech you of your own state, take care. This dream of mine, being now awake, I'll but milk my ewes and weep.
How now, good shepherd? Speak, ere thou diest.
I cannot speak, nor think, nor dare to know that which I know. Oh, sir, you have undone a man of 83. Oh, cursed wretch! Thou knewest this was the prince, and yet wouldst still dare to mingle faith with him. Undone! Undone! If I were to die within this hour, I would have lived to die when I desire.
What
Why look you so upon me? I am but sorry, not afeard, delayed, but nothing altered. What I was, I am.
My gracious lord, you know your father's temper. At this time, he will allow no speech, which I do guess you do not purpose to him. And as hardly will he endure your sight as yet, I fear. Then, to the fury of his highness settle, come not before him.
I not purpose it. I think, Camillo?
Even he, my lord.
How often have I told you it would be thus? How often said my dignity would last but till it were known?
It cannot fail but by the violation of my faith. And let nature crush the sides of the earth together and mar the seeds within. Lift up thy looks. From my succession, wipe me, father. I am heir to my affection.
Be advised.
I am, and by my fancy, if my reason will thereto be obedient, I have reason. If not, my senses, better pleased with madness, do bid it welcome.
This is desperate, sir.
So call it, but it does fulfill my vow. I needs must think it honesty. Not for all Bohemia will I break my oath to this, my fair beloved. Therefore I pray you, as you have ever been my father's honored friend, when he shall miss me, as in faith, I mean not to see him any more. Cast your good counsels upon his passion. I am put to sea with her whom here I cannot hold on shore. And most opportune to our need, I have a vessel rides fast by, but not prepared for this design. What course I may take, shall nothing benefit your knowledge, nor concern me the reporting.
My lord, I would your spirit easier for advice, or stronger for your need.
Hark, Perdita, I'll hear you by and by.
He's resolved for flight. Now, were I happy, if his going I could frame to serve my turn, save him from danger, do him love and honor, purchase the sight again of dear Cecilia, and that unhappy king whom I so much thirst to see.
Now, good Camillo.
Sir, I think you have heard of my poor services in the love that I have borne your father.
Very nobly have you deserved.
Well then, if your project may suffer alteration, I'll point you to where you will have as such receiving as shall become your highness, where you may marry her. And, with my best endeavors in your absence, your discontenting father strive to qualify and bring him up to liking.
Oh, Camillo, may this almost a miracle be done.
Have you thought on a place whereto you'll go?
Not any yet. We profess ourselves to be the slaves of chance.
Then listen to me. Make for Sicilia, and there present yourself and your fair princess. Methinks I see Leontes opening his free arms and weeping his welcomes forth. Asks thee, the son, forgiveness, as 'twere in the father's person.
Worthy Camillo, what color for my visitation shall I hold up before him?
Sent by the king, your father, to greet him and to give him comforts. Sir, he shall not perceive but that you have your father's bosom there and speak his very heart.
I am bound to you. There is wisdom in this.
A cause more promising than a wild dedication of yourselves to unpathed waters, undreamed shores, most certain to miseries enough. No hope to help you.
Your pardon, sir, for this I'll blush you, thanks.
My prettiest Perdita, but oh, the thorns we stand upon. Camillo, preserver of my father, now of me. We are not furnished like Bohemia's son, nor shall we appear in Sicilia.
My lord, fear none of this. I think you know my fortunes do all lie there. It shall be so in my care to have you both royally appointed, that you may know you shall not want. One word.
Ha-ha, what a fool Honesty is, and Trust, his sworn brother, a very simple gentleman. I have sold all my trumpery as if my trinkets had been hollowed out as a benediction to the buyer, by which means I saw his purse's best in picture, and what I saw, I remembered. I could have filed keys off that hung in chains. No hearing, no feeling, but my sir's song. By this time of lethargy, I picked and cut most of their festival purses, and if not the old man came in with a woo-bub against the prince and his daughter, I had not left a purse alive in the whole army.
Nay, but my letters being there so soon as you arrive will clear that doubt.
And those you'll procure from King Leontes?
Shall satisfy your father.
Happy be you, all that you speak shows fair.
Who have we here? We'll make an instrument of this.
How now, good fellow?
Why shakest thou so? Be not afraid. Here's nobody that will harm thee.
I am but a poor fellow, sir.
Why be so still? Here's nobody that will steal from thee. Therefore, discase thee instantly, and exchange garments with this gentleman.
I am but a poor fellow, sir.
Nay, prithee, dispatch. The gentleman is half flayed already.
Are you in earnest, sir? I smell the trick on it.
Dispatch, I prithee.
Unbuckle, unbuckle. Fortunate mistress, you must retire yourself into some covert. Take your sweetheart's hat, pluck it o'er your brows, muffle your face, dislike in you, and as best you can, dislike in the truth of your own seeming.
I see the place lies that I must bear a part.
No remedy. Have you done there?
Earth.
Sorry, sorry. Should I now meet my father, he would not call me son.
Nay, you shall have no hat. Come, lady, come. Farewell, my friend.
Adieu, sir.
Oh, Perdita, what have we twain forgot? Pray you, a word?
What I do next shall be to tell the king of their escape and where they are bound, wherein my hope lies that I shall so prevail to force him after, in whose company I shall review Sicilia.
Fortune speed us. Thus we set on, Camillo, to the seaside.
The swifter speed, the better.
I understand the business. I hear it. To have an open ear and a quick eye and a nimble hand is necessary for a cut purse. A good nose is requisite also to smell out work for the other senses. I see this is the time that the unjust man doth thrive. The prince himself is a piece of iniquity casting away from his father. If I thought it was a piece of iniquity to acquaint the king withal, I would not do it. I would much rather conceal it. Therein am I constant to my profession. Aside, here's more matter for a hot brain. Every lane's end, every church, every session yields a careful man's work.
There is no other way but to tell the king she's a changeling and none of your flesh and blood.
Nay, but hear me. Go to then.
She being none of your flesh and blood, your flesh and blood has not offended the king. And so your flesh and blood is not to be punished by him.
I shall tell the king all, every word. Yea, and of his son's pranks too, who may I say is no honest man, neither to me nor to his father, to go about to make me the king's brother-in-law.
Indeed, brother-in-law.
Very wise puppies.
To the king, for what lies within this bundle shall make him scratch his beard.
I know not the impediment of the complaint to the flight of my master. I am not naturally honest, but am sometimes by chance. How now, rustics? Whither they bound?
To the palace. And it like your worship?
What? With whom? The condition of the bundle, and your names, your ages, anything that is fit to be known, discover.
We are but plain fellows, sir.
Lies, you are rough and hairy. Let me have no lying.
Are you a courtier? And it like you, sir?
I am a courtier. Seest not the court and these enfoldings? And seest not the gait of my walk in the court? And smellest not thy court odor from me? For I am a courtier, cup a pay, and I will either push or pluck back thy affairs from thee. So I command thee to open thy affair.
Our business, sir, is to the king.
What advocate hast thou to him?
I know not, and it like you, sir.
Advocate's the court word for pheasant. Say you have none.
None, sir. I have no pheasant.
How blessed are we that these are not simple men. But nature could have made me the same, so I will not disdain.
This cannot be but a greater courtier.
His clothes are rich, but he wears them not handsomely.
He seems to be more noble in being fantastical. A great man, I'll warrant.
The bundle there. What's in the bundle?
Sir, there lies such secrets within this bundle that none shall know but the king. Will come to the knowledge of it within the very hour if I come to the speech of him.
The king is not at the palace. He has gone to purge melancholy and air out. And if thou must know anything serious, the king is full of grief.
So 'tis said that his son were to marry a shepherd's daughter.
If that shepherd not be in hand fast, let him fly. The curses he shall receive, the beatings he shall bear, will break the back of men, the heart of the monster.
Think you so, sir?
Not he, but those who are close to him, though removed 50 times, will all come beneath the hangman. Some say that he shall be stoned, but that, say I, is not well enough for him.
The old man, heir son, do you hear? Ain't it like you?
He has a son. Who shall be flayed alive, then anointed over with honey, set on the head of a wasp nest. Then he shall be reunited with aquavita or some other hot infusion. Then, as raw as he is, he shall be set against a brick wall, with the sun looking with a southern eye at him, where then he shall be blown to death by flies. But what talk are we of these traitorly rascals? For you seem to be honest, plain men, tending your presence to the king. Come on.
He seems to be of great authority. Close with him. Give him gold. Show the inside of your purse to the outside of his hand, and no more ado. Remember, stoned and flayed alive.
And it's like you, sir, to undertake this business for us. I'll give you the gold that I have and make it much more. I'll leave my son in pawn to you until I do so.
After I have done what I promised?
Aye, sir.
Well, give me the moiety.
Comfort. Good comfort. We must to the king and show him our strange sights, for he must know that she is none of your daughter nor my sister. We are gone else. Sir, I will do all that this man says and remain a pawn until it be brought to you.
Well, tend your presence to the seaside. I will follow.
We are blessed in this man, as I may say, even blessed.
Let us do as he bids us. He was provided to do us good.
Sir, you have done enough and have performed a saint-like sorrow. Do as the heavens have done. Forget your evil. With them, forgive yourself.
Whilst I remember her and her virtues, I cannot forget my blemishes in them. So still think of the wrong I did myself. That heirless it hath made my kingdom and destroyed the sweetest companion.
True. Too true, my lord. She you killed would be unparalleled.
She I killed. I did so. But thou strikest me sorely to say I did. It is as bitter upon thy tongue as in my thoughts.
Not at all, good lady, for you might have spoken 1,000 things that would have done the time more benefit.
You are one of those would have him wed again.
If you would not so, you pity not the state, nor the remembrance of his most sovereign name. Consider little what dangers, by his highness' fail of issue, may drop upon his kingdom.
There is none worthy respecting her that's gone. Besides, the gods will have fulfilled their secret purposes. For has not the divine Apollo said that King Leontes shall not have an heir till his lost child be found? 'Tis your counsel, my lord, to the heavens be contrary. Oppose against their wills. Care not for issue. The crown will find an heir.
Good Paulina. Oh, that ever I had squared me to thy counsel. Then, even now, I might have looked upon my queen's full eyes. Have taken treasure from her lips.
And left them more rich for what they yielded.
Fear thou no wife. I'll have no wife, Paulina.
Will you swear never to marry, but by my free leave?
Never, Paulina.
Then, good ladies, bear witness to his oath.
Good madam!
I have done! Yet, if my lord will marry, if you will, sir, no remedy, but you will. Give me the office to choose you a queen.
Good Paulina, we shall not marry till thou bidst us.
That shall be when your first queen is again in breath. Never till then.
One that gives out himself, Prince Florizel, son of Polixenes, with his princess, she, the fairest I yet beheld, desires access to your high presence.
His approach, so out of circumstance and sudden, tells us 'tis not a visitation framed, but forced by need and accident. His princess, say you with him?
Aye, the most peerless piece of earth, I think, that ever the sun shone bright on.
Oh, Hermione, madam, your verse flowed with her beauty once. 'Tis truly ebbed to say you have seen a better.
Pardon, madam, she is the rarest of all women.
Nay!
Go, Cleomenes, yourself, assisted with your honored friends, bring them to our embracement. Still, 'tis strange he thus should steal upon us.
Had our prince, jewel of children, seen this hour, he'd had pair well with this lord.
There is not a full month between their deaths.
Prithee, no more. Cease. Thou knowest he dies to me again when talked of. Were I but 21, your father's image is so hitting you, his very heir, that I should call you brother, as I did him. Most verily welcome, and your fair princess, goddess. Oh, alas, that I lost a couple that twixt heaven and earth, that might have stood here thus, begetting wonder, as you, gracious couple, do. And then I lost all mine own folly, the society of your brave father, whom I desire my life once more to look on him.
By his command have I here touched Cecilia, and give you all the greetings that a king, a friend, can send his brother. And but infirmity, which waits upon worn times, hath something seized his wished ability. He had himself the lands and waters twixt your throne, and is measured to look upon you, whom he loves.
Oh, my brother, good gentleman, the wrongs I have done thee stir afresh within me. Welcome hither, as is the spring to the earth. And hath he too exposed this paragon to greet a man not worth her pains?
Good, my lord, she came from Libya.
Ah, where the warlike Smalus, that noble and honored lord, is feared and loved?
Most royal sir, from thence, from him, whose daughter his tears proclaimed his, parting with her thence, a prosperous south wind friendly, we have crossed to execute the charge my father gave me for visiting your highness.
You have a holy father, against whom I have done sin, for which the heavens, taking angry note, have left me issueless, and your father's blessed. What might I have been, might I a son and daughter, now have looked on such goodly things as you.
Please you, great sir, Bohemia greets you from himself by me, desires you to attach a son who has his dignity and duty both cast off, fled from his father, from his hopes, and with a shepherd's daughter.
Where's Bohemia? Speak!
Here in your city, I came from him to your court. Whiles in haste and chase of this fair couple, meets he on the way the father of this seeming lady, and her brother, who have both their country courted with this young prince.
Camillo has betrayed me.
He's with the king, your father.
Who? Camillo?
Camillo, sir, I spake with him earlier. He now has these poor men in question. Bohemia threatens them with diverse deaths.
Oh, my poor father.
You are married?
We are not, sir, nor are we like to be.
My lord, is this the daughter of a king?
She is. When once, she is my wife.
I am most sorry you have broken from his liking when you were tied in duty, and sorry your choice is not so rich in worth as beauty that you might well enjoy her.
Dear, look up. Though fortune, visible an enemy, should chase us with my father, power no jot hath she to change our loves. Beseech you, sir, step forth mine advocate. At your request, my father will grant precious things as trifles.
Would he do so, I'd beg your precious mistress, which he counts but a trifle.
Sir, my liege, not a month for your queen's death, she was worth more gazes than what you look upon now.
I thought of her even in these looks. But your petition is yet unanswered. I will to your father. I am friend to them and you, for which errand I now go toward them. Therefore, follow me and mark what way I make. Come, good my lord.
Beseech you, madam, were you present at the relation?
I was by at the opening of the bundle, heard the old shepherd deliver the manner of how he found it, whereupon, after a little amazedness, we were all commanded out of the chamber. Only this methought I heard the shepherd say, he found the child.
I would most gladly know the issue of it.
I make a broken delivery of the business, but the changes I perceived in the king and Camillo were very notes of admiration. A notable passion of wonder appeared in them. Here comes a gentlewoman that knows more. The news?
The oracle is fulfilled. The king's daughter is found. Such a deal of wonder is broken out within this hour that even ballad makers cannot be able to express it. Here comes the lady Paulina Stewardess. She can deliver you more. How goes it now? Has the king found his heir?
Most true. There is unity in the proofs. The mantle of Queen Hermione's, her jewel about the neck of it, the letters of Antigonus bound with it, which they know to be his character, the majesty of the creature in resemblance of the mother, and the affection of nobleness which nature shows above her upbringing, and many other evidences proclaim her with all certainty to be the king's daughter. Did you see the meeting of the two kings?
No.
Then have you lost the sight which was to be seen, cannot be spoken of? Our king, being ready to leap out of himself for joy of his found daughter, cries, oh, thy mother, thy mother. Then asks Polixenes forgiveness. Then embraces his son-in-law. Then again worries he his daughter. And now he thanks the old shepherd. I have never heard of such another encounter.
And what, pray you, became of Antigonus that carried hence the child?
He was torn to pieces by a bear. Oh. This avouches the shepherd's son, who has a handkerchief and rings of his that Paulina knows.
And what became of his bark and his followers?
Wrecked the same instant of their master's death and in the view of the shepherd. But oh, the noble combat that twixt joy and sorrow was fought in Paulina. She had one eye declined for the loss of her husband, one eye elevated that the oracle was fulfilled. She lifted the princess from the earth and so locks her in embracing as if she would pin her to her heart that she might no more be in fear of losing.
The dignity of this act was worth the audience of kings and princes, for by such was it acted.
One of the prettiest touches of all was when, at the relation of the queen's death, she did, with an alas, I would fain say, bleed tears. For I am sure my heart wept blood. Who was most marveled there changed color, some swooned, all sorrowed.
Are they returned to the court?
No. The princess, hearing of her mother's statue, which is in the keeping of Paulina, a piece many years in doing and now newly performed by that rare Italian master, Giulio Romano, who he so near to Hermione, hath done Hermione that they say one would speak to her and stand in hope for answer. Thither with all greediness of affection are they gone.
I thought Paulina had some great matter there in hand, for she hath privately twice or thrice a day, ever since the death of Hermione, visited that removed house. Shall we thither and with her company peace the rejoicing?
Let's along.
Please, please. Finally.
Now, if I had not a dash in my former life in me, what preferment drop on my head? I brought the old man and his son aboard the prince, but he at the time, overfond of the shepherd's daughter, and being seasick, and himself little better, the mystery remained undiscovered. But 'tis all one to me, for if I'd been the finder of the secret, it would have relished underneath my other discredits.
Come, son, for I am past more children. but thy sons and daughters shall be all gentlemen born.
You are well met, sir. You denied to fight with me this other day, because I was no gentleman born. Try whether I'm not now a gentleman born.
I see you are now a gentleman born.
Aye, and have been these past 4 hours.
And so have I, boy.
And so you have. But I was a gentleman born before my father. The king's son took me by the hand and called me brother. And the two kings called my father brother. And the prince my brother. And the princess my sister called my father father. And so we wept. And those are the first gentlemanlike tears that ever we shed.
I humbly beseech you, sir, to pardon all that I have done to you, and give your good word to the prince, my master.
Prithee, son, do be gentle, for we are gentlemen.
Thou wilt amend thy life?
Aye.
And give me your hand. I will swear thou art an honest and true man in all of Bohemia.
Say it, but not swear it.
Not swear it. I'm a gentleman, I'll swear it.
How if it be false, son?
If it be false, a true gentleman may swear it on behalf of his friend. Give me your hand. The princesses and the princes, our kindred, are going to see the queen's picture. Come, follow us. We'll be thy good masters.
Son, do change out of that. You look like a fruitcake.
O grave and good Paulina, the great comfort that I have had of thee.
What, sovereign sir, I did not well, I meant well.
Good Paulina, we honor you with trouble, but we came to see the statue of our queen. Your gallery have we passed through, but we saw not that which my daughter came to look upon, the statue of her mother.
As she lived peerless, so her dead likeness, I do well believe, excels whatever yet you looked upon or hand of man hath done. Therefore, I keep it lonely, apart. But here 'tis. Prepare to see the life so lively mocked as ever still sleep mocked death. Behold, and say 'tis well. I like your silence. It the more shows off your wonder. But yet speak. First you, my liege. Comes it not something near?
Her natural posture. Chide me, dear stone, that I may say thou art Hermione. But Paulina, Hermione was not so wrinkled, nothing so aged as this seems.
Oh, not by much.
So much more our carver's excellence, which lets go by some 16 years and makes her as if she lived now.
I am ashamed. Does not the stone rebuke me for being more stone than it? Oh, royal piece, there's magic in thy majesty, which has my evils conjured to remembrance.
Give me leave to kneel and then implore her blessing. Lady, dear queen, that ended when I but began. Give me that hand of yours to kiss.
Oh, patience! The statue is but newly fixed. The color is not yet dry. Indeed, my lord, if I had thought the sight of my poor image would thus have wrought you, for the stone is mine, I would not have showed it.
Do not draw the curtain.
No longer shall you gaze on it, lest your fancy think undone it moves.
Let be. See, my lord, would you not deem it breathed, that those veins did verily bear blood?
Masterly done. The very life seems warm upon her lip.
The fixture of her eye has motion in it, and so we are mocked with art.
I'll draw the curtain. My lord is almost so far transported that he'll think a nun it lives.
Sweet Paulina makes me think so 20 years together. No settled senses of the world can match the pleasure of that madness.
I am sorry, sir. I have thus stirred you, but I could afflict you farther.
Do, Paulina, for this affliction has a taste as sweet as any cordial comfort. Let no man mock me, for I will kiss her.
Good my lord, forbear! The ruddiness upon her lip is still wet. You'll mar it if you kiss it. Stain your own with oily painting. Shall I draw the curtain?
No, not these 20 years.
So long could I stand by a looker on.
Either forbear, quit presently the chapel, or resolve yourself for more amazement. If you can behold it, I'll make the statue move indeed. Descend. Take you by the hand. But then you'll think, which I protest against, I'm assisted by wicked powers.
What you can make her do, I am content to look on. What to speak, I am content to hear. For 'tis as easy to make her speak as to move.
It is required you do awake your faith. Then all stand still.
Proceed. No foot shall stir.
Music, awake her. Strike. 'Tis time. Descend. Be stone no more. Approach. Strike all that look upon with marvel. You perceive she stirs. Start not. Her actions shall be as holy as you hear my spell is lawful. Do not shun her until you see her die again, for then you kill her double. Nay, present your hand. When she was young, you wooed her. Now in age is she become the suitor.
Oh, she's warm.
She embraces him.
If she pertain to life, let her speak, too.
Aye, and make it manifest where she has lived, or how stolen from the dead.
That she is living, where but told you should be hooted at like an old tale. Mark a little while. Please you to interpose. Fair madam, kneel and pray your mother's blessing. Turn, good lady, our Perdita is found.
Tell me, mine own, where hast thou been preserved? Where lived? How found thy father's court? For thou shalt hear that I, knowing by Paulina, that the oracle gave hope thou wast in being, have preserved myself to see this issue.
There's time enough for that, lest they desire upon this push to trouble your joys with like relation. Go together, you precious winners all. Your exaltation partake to everyone. I, an old turtle, will wing me to some withered bow, and there my mate, that's never to be found again, lament till I am lost.
Oh, peace, Paulina. Thou shouldest a husband taken by my consent, as I by thine, a wife. This is a match made betweens by vows. Thou hast found mine, but how is to be questioned? For I saw her, as I thought, dead, and in vain made many a prayer upon her grave. I'll not look far to find thee a husband. Come, Camillo, take her by the hand. Yes, you. Look upon, my brother, both your pardons, that I ever put between your holy looks my ill suspicion. This is your son-in-law, and son unto the great King Polixenes. Good Paulina, lead us from hence, that we may leisurely demand an answer to each part performed in this wide gap of time, since first we were dissevered. Hastily, lead away!
Thank you.
The king, therefore, has once again a son, a daughter too. Ere these 16 years to all Bohemia and all Sicilia as well. The great differences betwixt these two can ne'er o'ercome the truth that time has told.
I want to thank you for all the hard work that you've put into this show. None of this would have been possible if it weren't for you and all the behind the scenes. And thank you for so much for making Shakespeare something possible for us. We never thought we would have had fun with it, but we definitely have, thanks to you. Thank you so much. Have fun.